the stuff I'm going to focus on, the real sort of thought leader on this is Jenna Bednar, who's a professor at Michigan, who's also my partner. Andrea Jones Roy, who was a graduate student of mine who was at NYU and is now quit to become a circus performer. Oh. So, you know, that happened. It's always her dream. You know, so hey, it happened. Fun. Tracy Liu, who's a professor of economics at Tsinghua University in China. She was a grad student of mine. And then Yan Chen, who was a grad student of mine at Caltech long, long, long time ago, who's now a full professor at Michigan School of Information. And they're going to come on board about two-thirds of the way through the talk, or early on, about a third of the way through the talk, when I talk about some experimental work. So Jenna has done a lot of theoretical work. Andrea will be clear. The circus part will be clear as we move in. And the here's the experimental. So here's the idea. And the idea is primarily Jenna's, is that if you look at development efforts, you look at public policy work, and Jenna studies federalism. So one of the big things that interests her is, like, why is it that you can have the same constitution in two different countries, like in Argentina and the US, and it plays out completely differently? Why can two states operating within the same political system get very different policy outcomes? And in political science, there's a huge debate among people who sort of think, you can write down sort of a mathematical model, solve for the equilibrium, run the regression, do the sort of standard, what they call empirical integration of theoretical methods, and sort of explain everything with simple models. The other side of most political science departments and economic departments will argue that no, you've got to sort of do case-based research, right? You've got to be an area studies person of the area, right? So this is an attempt by Jenna to think about, can we sort of find some middle ground between these two things? And the idea is going to be something that we call games theory, which is the idea that instead of looking at sort of a single institution or a single game in isolation, we want to look at the full ensemble of games. So we're going to argue that sort of institutions have this sort of interesting interplay with culture. Now, the way I'm going to show how this works, I'm going to show you some agent-based models. This is the work that we did with Andrea. And then I'll show you a recent paper that's not published yet. It's sort of a mathematical model. So the themes that drive this is the following distinction, a distinction between sort of behavior versus belief. So I was trained as a game theorist. Jenna was trained as a Stanford political scientist, and when we think about sort of what drives outcomes in a political institution or an economic institution, we tend to think that, like, okay, people have preferences and they have beliefs. And the reason why you might get different outcomes in different places is people might have different beliefs, and beliefs drives things. We want to sort of make a different argument. We want to sort of assume that actually behavior matters more, and then when I think of an individual, whether I think of somebody in, you know, China, someone in Poland, someone in Sweden, someone in the United States, that they have this sort of ensemble of behaviors that they use. So when you sort of put somebody in an institutional setting, what they're going to do is they're going to sort of apply some behavioral rule that they might know from some other setting, and then from there they're going to learn. So rather than sort of posit an equilibrium, as I was trained to do, like sort of say, here's the equilibrium that game theory would tell you what happened when I went down to the institution, I'm going to assume that people sort of start with some sort of cultural behavior and then learn, and then something happens. What this is going to do is it's going to create some sort of outcome path dependence, and it's actually going to create what we call institutional path dependence, in the sense that, like, when I choose an institution, not only do I get outcomes, I get behaviors, and those behaviors affect what happens. Okay. So very quickly on culture. So it turns out to get tenure in anthropology, you've kind of got to have your own definition of culture. So, like, Rob Boyd and Pete Richardson, friends of mine, actually have this book where they started with 107 different definitions of culture, and then they say, okay, you can now say uncle and move on, right? But culture is basically sort of defines who we are. The first definitions are, like, you know, people like Tyler, 1870, it's a complex whole which includes knowledge, belief, arts, laws, morals, customs. The important thing for us is going to be this notion of a complex whole. The person who really makes sociology sort of a field is Boas, and again, he says the totality of mental and physical reactions. So again, this is all about there being some sort of fundamental essence or coherence to these behavioral responses to the environment. So it's not an idiosyncratic set of things that you do. The people who actually can write, who aren't academics, like Calvin Fleming, basically say, like, what culture is this? It's about coherence, right? It's about sort of like creating a coherent life to deal with the sort of mysteries of the and terrors of the inner and outer world, right? So the idea is that there's some semblance of coherence in terms of how we behave across domains. That's what people think about as culture. The standard of analysis, when we think about things like culture, are things about beliefs. So and preferences. So there's, this is work by my colleague Ron Engelhardt, a very famous political scientist, who basically has spent 30 or 40 years surveying people around the world and asking them their beliefs about things. And he's got, and he basically does factor analysis and says, look, you can put countries on two dimensions. One dimension is sort of survival and well-being. So you're just worried about sort of like, where do I get my next meal? This is about sort of, you're worried about like, where do I get my next latte? This is sort of traditional versus secular rational. So here you're very religious, and here you're wearing sort of multicolored hair up here. And so you end up with sort of rich, you end up with Sweden sort of way up here, and you end up with African countries way up here. And you get that this sort of, there's this nice map sort of between geography and these sort of measures of culture. If you come from a business school, there's a guy named Kurt Hofstede who studied business people. You need sort of this five-dimensional measure of culture. So here's an example. So Engelhardt asked people, generally speaking, would you say that people can be trusted? So this is the belief-based model. Are, you know, do you believe that people can be trusted? And what you get is you get that there's a range, right? So you see Poland and Hungary way down here, Czechoslovakia, and you see the Scandinavian countries way up here. So you can do maps of can you trust people, right, where yellow is high and orange is low, and you see this sort of geographic variation in whether you think people can be trusted. And there's some wonderful work by Paul Zak. If you actually can include one variable in a regression to predict GDP, this question works better than level of education, just barely, right? Which is kind of a frightening and scary thing. Okay. We want to propose an alternative unit of analysis, not because we think the other one's wrong, but again, because we think that like having a different set of models might be useful to try and understand. And this is based on some work by like Easterbrook in saying there's just this big puzzle that every time the international organizations come in and sort of the gold standard now is you do an actual experiment in one place and you find out, okay, what works? And then you go take it someplace else and it never works, right? And so we want to ask, is there some reason, can you explain why that may be the case? So we're going to steal from this guy, just directly steal from here, Diggerenzer, who has this notion of what he calls the adaptive toolbox. That what you want to do is you want to think of yourself as this sort of like toolbox of repertoires and skills that you use and you apply in different contexts and you constantly add to. Okay? So what Diggerenzer's notion of sort of cultural differences looks more like this. So here's this famous ultimatum game. How many have ever seen this? So player one is given $10 and you say you offer a split to someone. If they accept, each person gets their share. If they reject, they both get zero. So most people have sort of seen this. So this has been studied across a variety of countries and cultures. There's a famous paper by, actually a whole book by Bowles, Gintis, Kammer, Joel Henrich, and other people. There's places like the La Molera where they offer, people offer 570. The Aceh offer 480. The Machiginga only offer 260. It's fun teaching this at Michigan. More fun than teaching at Ohio State, more fun than teaching anywhere, because one of the small cultural groups happens to be University of Michigan undergraduates, which is kind of weird, because they're like, look at all these funky people. I'm like, yeah, and you are one of them, right? But what's interesting here is not that there's these differences. So this is like flat out cultural differences in behavior. Exact same game, right? And if you ask what causes this, what's interesting is the La Molera hunt whales collectively. So it's not surprising they would give more. The Machiginga don't even have personal names, so it's not surprising they would offer less. So what you're seeing here, one of the things that, when you read the book, what's fascinating when you talk to Sam and Urban Kahn about this, and Joe, what they say, what's really fascinating is you could predict from the culture, if you'd have asked an anthropologist how much they would give. Because you just know, because this is consistent with how people behave in other contexts. So here's the big idea then in like sort of 50 seconds. I was trained as a game theorist, you basically put some institution in play, there's going to be some Nash equilibrium that might say equal split. So in a standard bargaining game, Nash equilibrium say equal split. But what we want to think of is we want to think of culture as a petri dish. And so if I put an institution in some culture, I might not get 50-50. I might get 30-70. Or if I put it in a different culture, I might get 60-40. So this is the big debate within political science, where Jenna hangs out, right? Like, can I just sort of do Nash equilibrium analysis and then predict based on the institution this is what I should get? Or do I have to go travel to different places and deeply understand the culture to see what's going on, right? We want to argue, yes. You need to do Nash equilibrium analysis probably. You also need to understand the culture. But the thing is, what we want to do is we want to sort of use this notion of sort of behavior as a way to organize our thinking about what we might get. So it's not purely idiosyncratic. So this is the big idea, which is sort of game theory. So here's a simple game. When you meet someone you can either like shake or bow, right? So if we both shake, we both get four. If we both bow, we both get four. But if one of us shakes and one of us bows, somebody gets their eye poked out, right? So it's not good. So we both get a pair of zero. Here's a simple trust game. If we both trust each other, we get four. If we don't trust each other, we get zero. But if you trust me, and I don't act trusting towards you, you lose something, right? So it's costly to trust. And so this is where the belief behavior thing sort of becomes really subtle, possibly in our somewhat, sometimes the criticism is a bit semantic. If my beliefs are that I should trust you, right, then I'm more like that you're going to be trusting, then I should act trustworthy. There's also the question of, do you actually go through that loop thing, or is just trusting just something that you do? Like, I'm trusting in other settings, and so I don't actually even think about it. I just sort of think, oh, this is a situation where I should be trusting, right? So now we want to take sort of this work by my chair is going to say Leo Hurwicks, who was won the Nobel Prize in Economics and then State Writer, who he did most of his work with. These were my advisors in graduate school. And they have something called the Mount Writer Diagram. It's not named after Hurwicks for weird reasons. But the idea is this, there's some environment out there, you have some social objective, right? Like you want to have some, you know, some preferred outcome. And so what institutional design is all about is the following. You define some sort of message space or set of actions or rules by which people interact, and you assign an outcome function. So you basically, if people vote, whoever gets the most votes gets in office. So this is the institutional part, and here's the behavioral part. What game theory does is basically assumes that everybody's rational, and so this behavioral rule is Nash equilibrium or some sort of refinement. And the goal is to come up with a set of actions and outcomes mapping actions, right, outcome function mapping actions and outcomes, so that when people act rationally according to like game theory, what you get aligns with the social objective. This is, in some sense, the game of institutional design. This is how you should write constitutions. This is how organizations should write, you know, compensation schemes. This is how we should write public policy. Our idea is that that whole thing, you know, and again, the whole point of going to graduate school was to prove your advisors wrong, right? So this is the idea. We figured out we couldn't do that, so the better thing is to just sort of extend their idea. It's to say, look, it's not, so you want the environment to go to the outcome, but the thing is society doesn't consist of just one mechanism you can consider in isolation. There's a whole bunch of them, okay? And so everything I was taught in graduate school is you focus on creating this institution to get the outcome you want, right? But the trick, the insight, is that when you construct an institution, you create a behavioral repertoire. You create a set of behaviors, right? And this can come back to bite you, because that's going to affect how people perform in future institutions. So when I used to teach at, my first job was at Caltech coming up, and my wife got a job at Iowa, we went to Iowa, and she was teaching game theory, and she was teaching the prisoner's dilemma. And when you do experiments with Iowans, and the prisoners, they all cooperate, even in the one-shot prisoner's dilemma. And you have to teach them, right, to defect. And then they accuse you of teaching them to be bad people. Because defecting is just not in, I mean, if you grew up in rural Iowa as a farmer, you've never defected, right? It's just not what you do. So there's a large literature in psychology. Here's the stuff that's more sort of formal, I think, and sort of case-based or analogy-based reasoning. But here's some papers that people, in terms of like, that when I encounter a situation, I sort of look at it and say, is this like anything I've encountered before? And then I do the same thing. So this is what we're leveraging, get your answer, but these are sort of the formal models to do it. So now it's sort of more complicated. So institutions create outcomes, but they also create behaviors. Now these behaviors become the petri dish. And so now when I think about whether I choose institution A or institution B, I've got to ask, what's the petri dish look like in terms of what behaviors do people have? So for example, I taught at a place, Iowa. It was run by people from Chicago. One of our faculty members got sick, and the only way they could get someone to teach the course, the institution they had, was an auction. You know, like, who will do it for the least amount of money, right? Whereas when I got to Michigan, one of our professors went to jail. He was an adjunct. And we didn't hold an auction. People volunteered for the good of the university to fill that, right? So, but if you'd have said, for the good of the University of Iowa, someone teach this person's class who's sick with cancer, people would have said, how about the good of the university and $5,000, right? So once you've created a behavior repertoire, you have to pay for paper and pencils, right? everybody's going to work in a market-based logic, institutions not going to work. Okay, so before I show you the fundamentals, I'm just going to show you some experimental benchmarking. It's great, it's kind of wild, and this is the stuff that when we first presented the theoretical work, and we said this is great, you know, we'd like to see just some benchmark in terms of, like, does this actually happen in the lab? Can you get cases where these behavioral repertoires create these spillovers in future games? So you realize this is complicated, right? So you've got to have sequences of games, and we could do this, and we could probably do it really badly. So Yen Chen's a leading experimentalist. Tracy was a really ambitious and bright graduate student, and so Tracy decided to do this for a dissertation. It's just super, it's a great design, it was brilliantly done by Yen. So here's the standard prisoner's dilemma, right? Here's a game called the alternation game, which if you, for fun, you can go back and find some early versions of in game theory where people say, here's a prisoner's dilemma, and it's not a prisoner's dilemma. The reason why is 9 plus 2 is 11, which is better than 4. So if you play this game, you'd be better off alternating, okay? So here's what Tracy and Yen did. They had people, figuratively, you're not actually, you have computers, in a circle. So it starts out, you're playing one game with the person on your right, right? And this person's playing this game with the person on the left. And this could be the prisoner's dilemma game. You play that for a couple hundred rounds. Now we add a second game, and you play that game with the person on your left. So each person's playing two games, okay? And we have six different games and two different combinations. This was like a ton of treatments. Sucked up a lot of money from our information school to do this. But here's the interesting, so in sequence one, you play the prisoner's dilemma game first, and you develop behaviors there, and then you play the prisoner's dilemma in the alternation game. In the other one, you first play the alternation game, and then we add the prisoner's dilemma game. Here's what's really weird. In this sequence, when you play the prisoner's dilemma game, eventually people figure out how to cooperate. When you hand them the alternation game, they cooperate in that. Okay. Well, that's not bad. You're both getting a payoff of 4. It's better than getting a payoff of 3, right? And you can think that, hey, you know, but this is just flat out a behavioral spillover. Here's a really amazing thing. It's fairly hard to get people to alternate in that alternation game, right? Because you've got to, like, so when you, if you just play the alternation game, about a third of the time you get people alternating, 40-50% of the time you get people cooperating. So you can say this isn't as good as good people did, but we got like 90% of people cooperating, right? And about 30% of the time people might deem us to call it dog's breakfast, right? Things are just all over the place. They never play this game out, right? Of the 12 teams that learned to alternate in the alternation game, so think of these tables of four. So these two people are playing, these two are playing. When both of them are alternating, the 12 tables where both of them are alternating, 9 of those 12 tables, when they played the prisoner's dilemma, alternated for 200 rounds. So let's think about this for a second. They are doing something really complicated that's inefficient. Now, the really weird thing is, like, it's not clear how you, like, you say, is this statistically significant? It turns out, yes, it is. But if you count as a Charlie Plott said, the prisoner's dilemma game is basically played experimentally probably about 20,000 times. No one has ever had 75% of the groups alternate, right? That's like, you know, flipping a coin and having it land on the edge 9 out of 12 times. I mean, it's just so outside the realm of plausibility that this would happen in these fuckers. So the explanation has to be, right, that there's some, they knew how to alternate, it looks similar, they did the same thing.
Yeah, is it, could there be a function of priming?
Well, it's not something, so, but it's, it is, it depends on what you want to call, so what we think of it as, and we thought about using that language, just kind of like behavioral priming, right? So what happens is, like, I have this, and here's where we're taking Gigerenzer's view of this, and Gilboa and Schmeider's, like, I have this behavior and it's worked in this setting, right? Now you show me something else that looks kind of close, right? And I think, hey, I think I'll do this thing that I did over there, and it kind of works, and so I just keep doing it, right? Yeah, so it's not priming them. So priming typically means, like, you know, sort of getting you to think like a lawyer so you can be more competitive or something. But this is more just sort of like creating a behavioral repertoire and asking, do people use it? So it's a guy, John Barron at Penn, who did this stuff where he had people, there's a really complicated, they give you three numbers, and there's a really complicated way to take the first number plus the second number to get the third, like 7 times the first minus 5 times the second, right? And then like the fifth one of these, you can just add the two numbers to get it, right? But everybody still uses the complicated rule. And then you did some other stuff where like, you basically have people taking left turns by making three rights, right? Because they just don't think, so there's a bunch of evidence from psychology about people sort of like applying the same sort of case-based rules in different settings. Our argument is gonna be that you have a set of behaviors that you use, that if they work okay in one setting, you can apply them someplace else. So let's take this more sort of an agent-based model. And here we're gonna have basically the following is how it's gonna work. We're gonna have these artificial agents play a game, and then we're gonna add other games on top of it. And we have seven games: Prisoner's Dilemma, Stag Hunt, Alternation, this knife edge game, the self-interest game, and I'll sort of say this: Prisoner's Dilemma, Alternation game. You've seen knife edge are different between cooperating and doing the alternation thing. Self-interest game, you get better off sort of defecting. So these all have these kind of like cooperation defecting sort of thing to them. Stag Hunt, the Stag Hunt is kind of like a trusting thing. This is better, but if you play B, you automatically get four, right? So if you're self-interested here, you automatically get four. The top right and bottom left, we threw in there, we created a separate set of column players and role players to sort of represent genders or racial groups. And the idea here is, you kind of are better off collectively if you defer to the column player, or particularly the role player. So let this person get eight, you get four. That's better than that person getting four, you're getting six. So like, you can imagine like this being like sort of a male-dominated outcome. So what we do is we basically use these. I'll go through this fairly quickly, because if you haven't seen this before, it's probably hard to get in one 30-second go-around, and if you've seen it before, it'll be kind of boring. But here's the idea. We use these things called two-state automata, which is a standard approach. So these states basically say, here I'm going to be cooperating, which we're going to call A. Here I'm going to be selfish. And then a set of rules for what I do based on what the other person's doing. So if the other person's cooperating, I stay cooperating. If the other person's selfish, I'm over here and I'm selfish. If the other person's selfish, I stay selfish. If they cooperate, I go back to here, right? And so this is just tit for tat. I put this asterisk here to tell me what do I do initially, right? So if you take all two-state automata, we're actually gonna use three-state automata in this certainly show. If you take all two-state automata, here's a grim trigger. I start up cooperating. As long as you cooperate, I cooperate. If you're ever selfish, I move over here. And then once they move over there, that's it, right? So you can also call this the Nero strategy. Don't even think about messing. Okay? So what's interesting about this is you write down all possible two-state strategies, which Andrew and I did. You can find 31 of the 32 in the literature. The only one you can't find in the literature is something we called SWAN, which is switch after nice. So anytime I cooperate, I move over here to be selfish for one period, and then I copy what you do, right? So, like, I was just nice, it's my turn, which is not in the literature, but it's in, you can see it every day in preschool, right? If you ever have children, switch after nice is sort of like a standard behavior. Kids.
Just curious, when you set up the scenario, tell the subjects how many times this will be repeated?
So in the experimental thing, when we did the beta testing, we did a bunch of different stuff. So one thing we did is, you know, there's a standard thing, you don't want to tell them when it's going to end. Like, you don't want to say it's 100 tournaments. So what we did, though, is we said there's going to be a 100-round learning phase, and then there's going to be a random ending phase, right? But we made it so the random ending phase didn't stop until you at least played 100 rounds. So all of our analysis is over the 100 rounds in the second phase. There's a wealth of data then. The interesting thing about this paper is that our referees on the paper thought it was so interesting that both sets of referees did replications and actually published them before ours got published, which was kind of funny, and found the same thing, right? And there's been sort of a groundswell of papers, experimental papers, playing multiple games, and we weren't the first to do it. It had been done a long time ago, but more just on sort of just looking at cognitive overload as opposed to the spillovers. And we basically come to the conclusion that two things are going on. One, there's a cognitive overload effect, right, in the experiments, and there's a spillover effect. Right, so if you have people play a simple game, it really doesn't affect you in another game. But once both games are complicated, then you see the effect. Okay, so the point is, you can have the same automata play two games differently by having different initial actions. So if in game one, I start here and use this automata, I'm playing tit for tat. But in game two, if I start here, I'm playing suspicious tit for tat. If I made this the grim trigger thing, if I start here in one game, I'm going to be caught and make it for, I'm going to be playing your trigger. And if I started here, I'd just be playing always defend. So we actually do these experiments with larger automata. But this will show you what happens for. So blah, 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 blah. Tit for tat, you can basically say, here's my initial action. right, cooperate, and then you can basically, you can basically, they've got an initial state, I'm in state zero, state one, they've got initial action, which is going to be cooperative effect, and then I've got these transitions, basically what I do from each of those four possible outcomes. So it means you can basically write any automata as just a set of six letters. Okay? Now, where this matters, and this is what I think is, I guess when you sort of get this graphically, is you have a fixed strategy, which is in this thing, regardless of what happens, I always cooperate. And here, I always defect. So if I'm in the cooperating state, I always cooperate. Defecting state, I always stay in the defecting state. I could match what the other person's doing. So if they cooperate, I stay in the cooperating state. If I'm in the defecting state, and they cooperate, I go back to the cooperating state. I could do the opposite of what the other person does, or I could switch, just automatically switch. So the reason that's important is now what I can do is I can say, okay, here is, like, so anybody that writes an agent-based model, they basically say, I'm going to start out with random agents, right? We basically say, okay, here are random agents. So here's sort of, do they start out fixed, matching, opposite, or switching, fixed, matching, opposite, or switching for the two states. So this is just a random distribution. So this you can think of as like the Petri dish, right? So Eleanor Ostrom has this wonderful book called Understanding Institutional Diversity, where early on in the book she says one of the really crazy things about doing experimental work in the lab or across different countries is it's just wild what happens in the first period. It's just total craziness, right? Because there's just a lot of heterogeneity in how people play these things the first time, and then things sort of settle down. This is just sort of saying, if you do, and this isn't something that I think a flaw of agent-based modeling, we assume, well, I'm starting with a random starting point. Well, you're starting with a uniform starting point across all these things, right? Which is very different from random. So this would be tit for tat. In the one state, I match what you do, right? If you're cooperating, I match what you do. And if you're defecting, I match what you do, right? This would be win, stay, lose, shift. If you cooperate, I match what you do. If you're selfish, then I do the opposite of what you do. So if you were selfish, I lost, so then I cooperate. But if you cooperated, I won, so I stay there. So what you can do, and this would be group trigger, if you're cooperating, I match. If you're selfish, I stay fixed, right? So what you can do is you can basically take each one of these things, I won't bore you with all 16 of them, you go through each one of these things, and it's a reasonable strategy. So those are the all selfish strategies. So initially, we're just gonna say these things are random, and then subsequently, this is the priming thing. So this is why I kind of like the word priming. When I play the second game in these simulations, I want to have people start from where they end up. So let me show you. So first of all, we set these things up. The payoffs I showed you make us look like, oh, you threw these things out. We actually, this was probably the hardest part of this work. We had to make it so that for each game that we used, there's an equilibrium in the set of automata, right? Because these automata are playing this game. It's got to be the case that there's an equilibrium that, like, no automata would want to change what it's doing, given what the other automata is doing. It gives you the efficient outcome. So that means we're setting up the model so it's possible to get the efficient outcome. Right? It's also the case, we set this thing up so you learn from your neighbors. There's what we call a best neighbor equilibrium, that if each person's copying their best neighbor, that it's possible to get a bad outcome as well. Right? Because if we set it up so that no matter what, you get a good outcome when people learn, then we just always get a good outcome. Right? So if you made the learning rule, you keep trying random things and copying anybody, then eventually the learning rule will always find the optimal outcome, right? Because you're checking everything. Okay. So here's what happens in sort of the one-shot games of the simulation. When you play the prisoner's dilemma, we get 100% of the time people playing the cooperative. So this stands for cooperative, selfish, alternative. So prisoner's dilemma, we always get cooperating. For the self-interest game, we should be selfish, we always get selfish. For top right, bottom left, we always get, with property one, we get people on one of the diagonals. For the alternation game, most of the time, right, we actually get people being selfish. Only occasionally, people, these are the automata, only occasionally do we get alternation. Alternation is hard. Now, what's interesting about this is that this is also true of human groups. It's harder to get them to alternate. And for the knife edge game, we get this sort of mix of diagonal and cooperation, and occasionally a selfish. Okay, so you want to ask, is there path dependence? Does the outcome of the game depend on the sequence of games? Or is there set dependence? Does the outcome depend on the set of games? Right, that's what we're asking for. Here is the knife edge game, right? Remember, you could. What's interesting is right? So here you see when the knife edge is played alone, you get less cooperative behavior when the knife edge is played after the prisoner's dilemma. But here's what's sort of really cool then about these graphs. Here's what happens if you play the knife edge game, right, after you've played it. So you've got some people who are in switch match, which is going to be, like, so when you're cooperative, you always switch, right? And then when you're selfish, you match what the other person does. That's going to give you, like, a nice alternating behavior. This, though, is like a grim trigger, right? Here's the behavioral spillover, right? If you play the prisoner's dilemma, you end up here, right? These are all matching in the cooperative phase, and then these are all, though, cooperative strategies in the prisoner's dilemma. And this is knife edge following prisoner's dilemma, right, which gives you more cooperation. So what you can see is, if you want to see sort of path dependence here, here is stag hunt and alternation. So this first graph, you play stag hunt first, right? And how's this work? Yeah, so this is where I'm playing stag hunt first, and this is when we're playing stag hunt second. So in the stag hunt game, if I play stag hunt first, I'm more likely to cooperate in the stag hunt, right? And if I play stag hunt second, I'm less likely to cooperate. If I play stag hunt first, which means alternation second, I'm more likely to get alternation in the alternation game. So what that means is, let me say this kind of more slowly, if I play stag hunt first and alternation second, I do better in both games. And that's because if I play stag hunt, I learn how to cooperate, right? And then when I learn how to cooperate, it's easy to go from learning how to cooperate to learning how to alternate. If I play alternation first, which is here, it's harder to learn how to alternate. A lot of us get stuck in selfish, which means that then when we play stag hunt, we've learned how to be selfish, we continue to be selfish. Okay? So the behavior matters. Now what's interesting here is the outcomes depend not just on whether people cooperate, but on how they cooperate, whether you use tit for tat or grim. So then here's the sort of interesting stuff, and now you'll see where I think this is what led Andy to the circus. You can think about a behavioral repertoire as being path limiting. If I have this set of behaviors and now I play this other game, it means that I'm not going to play it efficiently. Okay? So this is Andrea's sparkler graph. So here's game X. If I play game X first, and then I play, so we're looking at sequences of three games. This is where you have to use agent-based modeling and not experiment, because there's 216 different combinations. So you just couldn't do this many experiments. So you play game X first, then you play the prisoner's dilemma, then you play the stag hunt. That's how the sparkle works, right? So you just go from here, game X, the prisoner's dilemma, then self-interest or something. So here's bottom left. Here's the sparkle graph for bottom left. So bottom left is a game where we're saying the men get to win. If I play bottom left in the first game, and I play bottom left in the second game, this line here means that I can play this efficiently. So if I play bottom left, bottom left, bottom left, that works. If I play bottom left, knife edge, there's no line here. I can't play knife edge efficiently. I can't do it. If I play bottom left first, because the men win here, and I try and play knife edge, I can't do it, right? So if there's no line there, it means I'm not able to do it. So that we can then define what we just call the path efficiency. There's 49 possible paths from here. If I play bottom left first, there's only 25 that work. If I play the prisoner's dilemma, which has the highest, it turns out, 41 work. So then the question is, why? Right? Why, if I play the prisoner's dilemma first, can I do all this stuff? And why, if I play bottom left first, can I not do all this stuff? And now we're going to go back to the other graph. If I play bottom left first, everybody ends up sort of like in this behavior. So what you can use if you, in public policy, you guys probably study like the Herfindahl index, right, which is the effective number of firms. So you can compute the effective number of behaviors, or the effective number of parties, or for biologists, the number of species, Simpson's index, right? So it's just the sum of the squares of the probabilities. If you play bottom left first, the effective number of behaviors is 2.3. So essentially there's only two behaviors being played. That means everybody's locked into a handful of things. It's very hard to learn other stuff. So if I play bottom left first, and then I go try and play the prisoner's dilemma, I end up over here. Some crappy behavior. But if I play the prisoner's dilemma first, since all these different ways get you to cooperate, And this is true of the experimental, when we've presented this to experimentalists, they're like, yeah, this is so true. And you actually go back and look at the strategies people are playing, or ask people the strategies they're playing in the prisoner's dilemma. Some people say they're playing tit for tat. Some are playing win, stay, lose, shift. Some are playing grim trigger. Some people from Iowa are just like, oh, I'm just always playing nice. Right? There's a lot of them. I'm just nice. It's working. Right? Well, this is a lot of different behaviors. And so from there, you can move to a lot of different stuff. And so if you run a regression on either the, here I'm using effective neural behaviors regression, in the paper you used entropy, which is another measure of sort of the unpredictable what you're doing, that ends up being a really useful measure. So there's been a number like seven or eight recent papers sort of looking at strategic entropy and the ability to learn, and they're finding the same thing we find, right? That the more entropy there is in what you do, the more likely you are to be able to get the right answers. And remember the first thing I showed you where the automata were mostly able to find the right things? That's because we're starting with a random mix across all these behaviors, and so it's easy to sort of get there. But if you're like an evolutionary biologist, if you've got like all the species doing the same stuff, it's kind of hard to evolve your way to the right answer. Yeah, questions?
Does it matter how many iterations of the game?
So this we tried, this becomes this sort of like, you know, we tried to do the experiments probably the same number of rounds as this, and for a while Tracy went on this like major jag where she's like, figuring out like are people adopting the same speed as our automata, and you can do that, but then eventually we ended up just kind of tossing that out. So these things we were running, I think this stuff I think is 200 rounds, and with the people we're counting 100 rounds.
So does it vary the order of the games, and does it vary how long it takes to settle?
No, we were basically, that's why. This is a great question. So if we go back, way back to this graph, this is where sort of the science leaves the table and becomes the art of writing an agent-based model, right? We had to get the payoffs so that we could get efficient outcomes, we could get inefficient outcomes, and we had to have the learning algorithm parameters be such that within a couple hundred rounds, it was solving the games optimally. So if we only ran it for 50 rounds, like when we start, everybody's right here, right? And so then you want them running to the corners, right? Or not, or at least running to the edges, right? We did this, whenever you do an agent-based model, you want to have two people programming in two different languages, right? Who are in locked rooms, and then come back and say, wow, we got the same thing, right? Which is what, we actually had three people programming in three different languages in three different locked rooms, and we all got the same stuff. Just because we were so worried because there's just so many moving parts. Okay. But again, the big lesson here, which is really interesting, is that this this path limiting stuff and what you can do depends on what you did before. So this diversity implies less path limiting behavior. Okay. So now, the reaction again from sort of like our referees was, okay, but you know, can you sort of prove it? So let me just do this really, really quickly, and then we'll get the sort of general question. So what we did is we did the following. We said, okay, we're going to create something we call a behavioral spillover gamma. Okay, now this is how this is going to work. Let's suppose there's this game called the tradition innovation game. So there's this parameter theta, which is a payoff parameter. If we do opposite things, we both get 4. If theta is 0, we both do the traditional thing, we get 16. If we do something innovative, we get 0. If theta is 16, if we do the innovative thing, we get 16. And if we do the same thing, we get 0. So theta can vary. As theta moves from 0 to 16, innovating becomes efficient. Whereas if theta is really small, being the traditional thing becomes efficient. So if I start out with a theta here, people should sort of do the traditional thing. But what if I then, suppose I play a game here at 7, and then I play a game at 9. We should say, well, now it's the efficient thing is to be innovative. But we assume there's a behavioral spillover. So how does this work? If the behavioral spillover is set at 75%, it means that when people encounter this game, they say, wow, that looks a lot like that other game. And so 75% of the people start out by doing what they did in the other game. 25% of the people like open their game theory book and solve for the efficient equilibrium and play that outcome. Then what they do is they literally, now there's a question of which learning rule do you apply. We decided to use Nash's learning rule, from Nash's original paper. It's the best response learning rule, okay? So here's what happens, if theta equals 9, even though the best thing to do is to innovate, if 3/4 of the people are playing traditional, your payoff for being traditional is actually higher than your payoff from innovating, and so what happens is you play traditional. So what you get is that you play traditional in this game. If you started with the 9 game, you'd innovate, right? And then if you played this one, you'd also innovate. So you get the order would matter, right? And you can sort of, but now instead of doing this automata, we're basically proving this analytically by saying, here's the spillover, here's the learning rule, right? Here's the other. So what we basically prove is this, that for any one of these games, we're doing 2 dimensions as well. There's a region of the space that's going to be, this is sort of the grand consilience of the 2 parts of political science. There's going to be an immune region. If the incentives are strong enough, the culture is not going to matter. What people are playing in other games aren't going to matter. So this is going to be immune, this is going to be immune. But this whole region is susceptible. So then the question becomes, how do you get, what you'd like to get is you'd like, if you've got these institutions, you'd like to get the right outcome in every one. Right, so let me sort of jump to the, there's all this stuff about institutional context and stuff. But here's the really interesting thing. If I have a low spillover, then I can ask, this is sort of telling me, where do I end up, where's the threshold end up? What you get is you get that a lot of the time it ends up somewhere sort of in the center. If I just kind of randomly throw out games. If I have a high spillover, then it ends up way at these extremes and never in the center. So what's interesting is, if I make the spillover tiny, if I assume there's no behavioral spillover, then game theorists are right. You're going to get the efficient outcome in every one of these games. As I make the spillover larger, you get path dependence. As I make the spillover a lot larger, you get initial game dependence. Whatever the initial game is determines what happens. And you can do this in terms of odds ratios if you want, right? So this is the likelihood that where your threshold ends up on the side of the best, the first game. And if you start with a really high threshold, you're 5 times as likely to have your final threshold being the best. So the last point, this is going really fast, is then this question of like, how do you do up?